Good morning. Our passage this morning is in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 2 through 16. The roles of men and women in the church. I drew the short straw. I'm kidding. 1 Corinthians 11, verses 2 through 16. Let's go ahead and read that together. Paul writing to the Corinthians. I praise you for remembering me in everything and for holding to the traditions as I pass them on to you. But I want you to realize that the head of every man is Christ. The head of the woman is man, and the head of Christ is God. Every man who prays or prophesies with his head covered dishonors his head. But every woman who prays or prophesies with her head uncovered dishonors her head. It's the same as having her head shaved. For if a woman does not cover her head, she might as well have her hair cut short. But if it is a disgrace for a woman to have her hair cut short or her head shaved, then she should cover her head. A man ought not to cover his head, since he is the image and glory of God. But a woman is the glory of man. For man did not come from woman, but woman from man. Neither was man created for woman, but woman for man. It is for this reason that a woman ought to have a symbol of authority on her head because of the angels. Nevertheless, in the Lord, woman is not independent of man, nor is man independent of woman. For as woman came from man, so also man is born of woman. But everything comes from God. Judge for yourselves. Is it proper for a woman to pray to God with her head uncovered? Does not nature itself teach you that if a man has long hair, it is a disgrace for him? But that if a woman has long hair, it is her glory? For long hair is given to her as a covering. Now, if anyone wants to be contentious about this, we have no other practice, nor do the churches of God. Now, that seems pretty clear to me, pretty cut and dried. I mean, I don't really know what else to add to that, so I think what we're going to do is I'm just going to, instead of giving a sermon, we're going to pray, cut this off early, and go have some snacks. Yeah. Actually, what I want to do is pray. Maybe Jesus will come back before we get started. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you so much for your goodness to us. Thank you that your word is eternal, that not a dot will pass away from it. And you have communicated it to us. You both put it on paper, parchment, and allowed it to be translated and protected through the ages so we might have these written records of your word, but also you speak it in our hearts. And so we ask you to do that this morning, that you would speak words of life and words of power to us. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Actually, this passage is not as tough as I make it out to be. But it is a masterpiece. There are a lot of intricate parts in this passage, and we need to be careful. And so as a result, we've decided to take 2 weeks on this passage. Hey, Jackie, I didn't see her. It's a nice surprise. So this week, we're basically going to look at verses 2 and 3. And then next week, we'll look in greater detail at more of the application. But this week, I want to look at the eternal principle that God gives for us here. Now, I do believe that this topic is of profound importance for us today in America and in the church. I mean, has there ever been a time when there was greater confusion about gender distinctions and gender roles and gender questions than there are in our society today? I doubt it. Now, before we get started here, let's clarify what this passage is about and what it's not about. First of all, contrary to what the section title might say in your study Bible, this passage is not primarily about women head covering. It's not. Even though the topic of head coverings comes up and is mentioned a lot in this passage, the main point of the passage is God's creative order of authority, his pattern of authority that is an eternal truth in creation and in the church. So Paul begins this section of the letter in verse 2 with a commendation. He says in verse 2, to the Corinthians, I praise you for remembering me in everything and for holding to the traditions just as I passed them on to you. As we've seen already, Corinth was a mess as a city. I mean, It had all kinds of cultural and sinful problems in this old military outpost that was Corinth. There are a lot of problems from that culture that seeped into the church. Not that it actually seeped in. It was just that people in the culture were getting saved, and as people got saved, they came into the church, and they brought their culture with them. When you get saved, you don't get divorced from your culture, and so they were bringing these ideas and these attitudes and these worldviews into the church. But Paul commends them for holding on to the things that he had brought to them, that he had imparted to them. When Paul planted the church in Corinth, way back when, he stayed there for a year and a half, probably longer than he'd ever stayed in any single place before. And he imparted a lot of truth to the Corinthians while he was there. So basically, what you would have had if you were first century Christian was the Old Testament would have been the only written record you had, and maybe any apostolic letters that happened to make it to your locality. But most of what you would have to go on would have been the oral teachings of the apostles. That was the record, and that's the quote-unquote tradition that Paul's talking about here. These are the teachings that Paul left with them, his apostolic teaching. Not human traditions, but biblical New Testament teaching. But, Paul says in verse 3, I want you to realize, or literally, but I want you to know, I would have you know. In other words, here's something that you don't have from me. Here's something that either you're not doing right or I never actually imparted to you. So either because Paul was getting reports from people who had been through Corinth or maybe from the letter that the Corinthians had written to him, Paul knew that there was confusion in Corinth concerning the roles of men and women. And so he writes to have them know these things. Now remember, we're still in that section in 1 Corinthians that began in chapter 8. And it's still going on right now. So all throughout this whole section, Paul has been adamant that respect and love for the other person is more important to a mature believer than exercising your rights and your freedoms in Christ. You may have certain rights and freedoms in Christ that you have to set aside if you're truly going to love people. Now, the Corinthians were proud of the freedoms that they enjoyed in Christ. And they were having a hard time putting love ahead of their freedoms. For instance, the mature believers in Corinth knew that it didn't matter what meat you ate. Idols aren't anything. So if you have a plate of meat in front of you, give thanks to God. God's the one who made the meat, and eat it without question. Even if it was sacrificed to an idol. And that was the freedom that the Corinthians wanted to enjoy. But Paul says, okay, yeah, but your first concern in all of these things needs to be love. Love modifies your freedom in Christ. Our first thought as Christians should not be, what rights do I have? What freedom do I have? But rather, how can I build into the life of my brother or sister in Christ? Or, like we saw last week, how can I best live in a way that I can build connections into the lives of the unsaved so that I can shine the light of the glory of the gospel in their lives? And that's really where we find ourselves again right here in chapter 11. It is the responsibility of mature believers to protect the weak in honor and respect and in conscience. Love always is the guiding principle. Now, we see that the Christian community at Corinth was getting some things right. I mean, up until the time of Christ, women in that part of the world had very few rights, very few freedoms. And now, with the coming of Jesus and with the coming of the gospel, women suddenly had this newfound freedom. And it's obvious in our passage that women were joining the public worship at Corinth. That's a good thing. That's progress. Look at verse 5. It clearly says that women were praying and prophesying in the church. That's revolutionary. The Jews did not allow women to participate in the general assembly. The pagans did not allow women to participate on an equal footing with men at the temple. Women in the ancient Near East were second-class citizens at best. Women across that region at this time, Paul's time, basically had the social status of a slave. So when people claim that it's Christianity that subjugated women and oppressed women, all they're really doing is showing their ignorance. Do you want to know what the status of women would be like in the Western world if it wasn't for the gospel? You don't have to guess. You can observe it in our world today. Can you think of a Middle Eastern culture that has the same culture today as it did 2,000 years ago when Paul was walking around? Yeah. Muslim societies. Look at a Muslim society and see how they treat women, and you will see how women were treated at the time of Paul. Because, and this is no fault to the Muslims, it's our fault, the gospel has not penetrated the Muslim lands. Because of our own neglect and because of our own prejudices, we have not carried the gospel to the Muslim parts of the ancient of the Near East as we should. And so the culture of the Near East in many places is exactly the way it was in the ancient Near East. So in most of those places, women are still treated exactly as they were at the time of Christ. So there, women are still denied basic human rights. Women can't vote. In most of those places, women can't drive. In most of those places, a woman cannot go out of her house without an escort or being completely covered with clothing. But that's not the way it is in Christianity. Jesus honored women. Jesus showed them real love and real dignity and real respect. In a time when little girls were not even allowed to go to school, Jesus had women disciples. No respectable teacher, no respectable rabbi would have women disciples. Jesus had many, and he honored them with the highest regard. And not just them, even women who weren't part of his culture. Do you remember the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman? Do you remember how Jesus treated her? I mean, he trampled all kinds of cultural taboos when he interfaced with that woman. I mean, first of all, he greeted a woman of Samaria, for crying out loud. And he talked to her. He struck up a conversation with this woman. And beyond that, he asked her for something unheard of. He asked her for a drink of water. And then going beyond, and this was not lost on this woman, he drank, apparently, from the same cup or ladle that she had drank from. It's crazy. Jesus is communicating something to this woman. He is lifting her up. And she's trying to hide herself, and he lets her know, no, I know your heart, and I know where you've been. And then finally, to the astonishment of everybody, Jesus gently and respectfully offers this woman a gift. This woman who had always only ever been abused and mistreated and used, he offers her the gift of eternal life. And all throughout the Gospels, we see Jesus interacting with women just like that. And it didn't stop with Jesus. I mean, Christianity literally turned society on its head. Turn with me to Acts chapter 6. We'll just take a real quick look at this. The first century Christians weren't perfect. They had a lot of problems. They had problems like we have problems. They were interpersonal problems. Acts chapter 6, beginning in verse 1, gives us a really good glimpse at one of those problems. Acts 6:1 says, quote, in those days when the number of disciples was increasing, so Pentecost has already happened, the Holy Spirit's been poured out and the church is exploding. It says, as the number of disciples was increasing, the Hellenistic Jews, the Greek Jews, among them complained about the Hebraic Jews, the cultural Jews, because their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. So the 12 apostles gathered all the disciples together and said, it would not be right for us, the 12, to neglect the ministry of the Word of God in order to wait on tables. Brothers and sisters, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom. We will turn this responsibility over to them, and we'll give them, and then we'll give our attention to prayer and the ministry of the word. Well, this proposal pleased the whole group, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit, also Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas from Antioch, a convert to Judaism. And they presented these men to the apostles, who prayed and laid their hands on them. So here was this conflict in the early church about distribution of food to widows, to women. And so what did the apostles decide to do? Well, they put forth the 7 godliest men that they could find and put them in charge of waiting on tables. Whose tables? Tables of the women. This is revolutionary. This is unbelievable. For outsiders looking in, they would have been stunned by this. The women were seated, the men were standing, serving tables by the direction of the Holy Spirit. Now, speaking of the Holy Spirit, think back to when the Holy Spirit was poured out on the church. Do you remember that? Do you remember the prophecy of Joel? Does the Spirit make any distinction between men and women according to the prophecy of Joel, or according to what actually happened that day in Pentecost to the early church? No, it says, in the last days, God says, I will pour out my Spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. You're all going to get a full measure of my Spirit. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my Spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. The coming of the gospel absolutely revolutionized women's standing in society. Someone once said that it's very fitting that it was women who were first at the cradle and last at the cross. And it's not like this was some kind of afterthought in the mind of God. You know, like when Jesus came into the world, God's like, you know what? We should honor women. No, look back to Proverbs 31. Proverbs 31, written almost 1,000 years before the time of Christ. It describes what a godly woman looks like. Proverbs 31 says that godly woman's strength and dignity are her clothing. You don't have to turn there. It says she's involved in real estate. She buys a chunk of land and she clears it and plants a vineyard, right? She takes care of the poor and needy. She makes clothes and sells them. I guess she had an Etsy store. And all the while, she's taking care of her own family. Now, ladies, I'm not saying this to like lay this heavy burden on your shoulders. Like, you know, you haven't even started a vineyard yet. Come on, get with it. What are you doing? What do you sell at in your Etsy store? No, not at all. What I'm trying to do is show that even 1,000 years before Jesus, in the mind of God, the pattern of God, God's dignity and idea for women, this woman was not at home under lock and key, under the thumb of her oppressive husband. No, she's out. She's engaged in public. She's innovative. She is industrious. She's active. And she's interfacing with the world around her. It says in verse 26 of Proverbs 31, she opens her mouth with wisdom and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. That's a godly woman. See, we see here really the intent of God. But man is evil. And as we'll see in Genesis next week, with our evil came a curse. And the curse precludes God's purpose for men and for women. And so men learn to dominate women rather than value and uphold them. And women learn to think lowly of themselves or flat out fight back. And so the gospel entered a worldwide culture that demeaned and degraded women. And that's the way it was at Corinth. And it's really important that we understand something about the culture at Corinth. Corinth was historically a Greek city, but it had been destroyed and rebuilt and repopulated by Romans. It was very much a Roman city. And throughout the ancient Near East in the first century, in Roman poetry, women were depicted as evil. Even in the art that we find in the city of Corinth, the ancient ruins, women are depicted as evil. Roman wives were under the absolute control and absolute authority of their husbands. And in Roman culture, women were actually often listed in a man's list of his possessions. His wife would be in that list as well. And so as a result, women, respectable women who went out into public in the Roman culture, were supposed to be covered. The way a woman clothed herself communicated a lot of things to herself, to the men in her life, and to society. So the idea of head coverings in first century Roman culture was important because it communicated. And thank God for archaeologists who are willing to go back and put in the sweat to figure these things out. But basically four observations about the things that are mentioned in our passage, just looking at the passage generally. First of all, in Roman society, according to archaeologists, a woman who went out in public with her hair covered with some kind of a hood or a scarf, you'll see it in the literature called a veil, but really it wasn't like a Muslim veil, but rather a scarf or a hood that was attached to a jacket that was pulled up over the head. A woman who went out with her head covered like that was basically sending a message to herself, to the men in her life, and to society, I am a respectable woman. Do not approach me. I'm not available. And people in society got the message. They understood that. Horace, the Roman poet who lived about the time Jesus was born, wrote that appropriate head coverings for respectable women served, quote, as a protection of their dignity and status as women who were not to be propositioned. That was the message that was being sent. Now, number two, a woman who went out into society without her head covered was seen as advertising her availability and even advertising her sensuality. It was a very clear message being sent. To the point that, at this time in history, Roman law would not even protect a woman who was assaulted if she was assaulted while her head was uncovered. As erroneous as that kind of thinking is, the Romans thought she brought it on herself. Now, I don't agree with the message, but that was the culture of the day. Third thing, a woman with short hair. According to Roman culture, a woman who cut her hair short, not cropped it all the way down to the nubs, but a woman who had short hair was trying to appear or even become more masculine. That was the message she was sending. And then a woman with her hair shaved, just buzz cut. That was seen as a woman who had completely abandoned her sexuality or maybe had been forced to abandon her sexuality because she was a slave maybe. And so it's entirely possible that these women who were in the church in Corinth were looking at these cultural norms and they were saying, no, we are not bound by man's rules. We are free in Christ. And so they knew that they had the freedom to wear their hair the way they wanted. And so they decided to buck the system, so to speak, and enjoy their rights and their freedoms in Christ, in the church, during worship. And so Paul writes, 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 2 through 16, to remind the believers that it is possible to exercise Christian freedoms and Christian rights in a way that's not loving, in a way that does not hold the interest of the other as the highest priority. See, the temptation apparently in Corinth was for these women to put their new knowledge and their new freedom before love. And so Paul points out in our passage that we just read, and we'll see more of this next week, that for a woman in the church to dress in a way that communicates that she's more masculine or communicates sensuality is not loving your brother. It's not thinking of others first. So at the beginning, in verse 3, Paul establishes a vital truth, a principle pertaining to an eternal truth about the flow of God's authority in creation. He says, but I want you to realize that the head of every man is Christ, the head of the woman is man, and the head of Christ is God. So Paul says, you need to understand this vital foundational truth, truth that is set apart from anything cultural, anything that is human custom. No, this is the truth of the order of the flow of God's authority, the pattern of God's authority. And it's the main point of our entire passage this morning. And so we'll be coming back to this again next week. God is the head of Christ. Christ is the head of man. Man is the head of woman. That's God's order. And yes, I know that we live in a day and an age where as soon as you hear that last phrase, you cringe. So let me ask you why. When we hear the phrase, man is the head of woman, why do we cringe? Why are we so uneasy with that eternal truth? Well, first, I came up with three reasons. I think maybe it's just because we're a product of our culture. We, as Christians, we have to continually be aware that our culture is trying to push us into its mold, into the pattern of this world. And our culture has been screaming so loud and so long that men and women are the same, that it has begun to mold us to their view, to the point that we not only see the world from their view, but we begin to see Scripture from their view. Now, whenever you decide something in God's Word needs to be changed or explained away because it doesn't fit with your worldview, maybe it's time to change your worldview to fit God's Word rather than try to change God's Word to fit your view. So we cringe. Because we've been told that men and women are the same. Not equal, not just equal, but the same. Now another reason, I think, second reason that we find it cringeworthy when we hear those words is that there have been abuses against women. Horrible abuses for centuries. And unbelievably in the church, even by the church. So I suspect that another reason for our uneasiness with this verse is that we are legitimately sensitive to the plight of women through history. So we read something that even appears to hint at an abuse of power by men, and our defenses go up, and that's probably a good thing. Third, another reason that I think this powerful truth causes us to be uneasy is that the middle clause seems to drown out the other two clauses. Did you notice that verse 3 actually has three clauses? Look at them again. Number 1, the head of every man is Christ. Number 2, the head of the woman is man. Number 3, the head of Christ is God. Because this issue is so sensitive with us, it's almost as though when we read this verse, the middle clause jumps off the page and slaps us in the face so loudly that we can't even hear the other two clauses. Because of our culture and because of our sensitivity, we miss everything else around it. If you read this, the head of the woman is man, and you automatically assume that it's chauvinistic or misogynistic, I would invite you to read the surrounding clauses. First, it says, the head of every man is Christ. Every man, not just Christian, everyone. Whether they recognize it or not, Scripture is clear. Every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Paul is laying out here a pattern of authority that transcends culture, that is eternal, and it pervades the universe, not just this earth and man's cultures. These are creation principles. And that's why, as we'll see next week in verses 8 and 9, he goes through the creative order of man and woman. And so then, when he gets to the second clause, he's not only talking about the relationship of a man to his wife, he's stressing the relationship of men to women. Not just in the context of human culture, but this is the way God planned it from the beginning of creation. But notice that the relationship of a man to a woman is placed in the context of man's relationship to Christ and in the context of Christ's relationship to the Father. Look at the last clause. The head of Christ is God. So whatever it means for a man to be the head of a woman, it means the same thing for God to be the head of Christ, for the Father to be the head of the Son. Do you imagine for a minute that the relationship between the Father and the Son is an abusive relationship, a domineering relationship, an adversarial relationship? Of course not. No. So the women in Corinth, they were exercising their freedom in fashion, if you will. I don't have to wear a head covering if I don't want to. I'm free in Christ. I can cut my hair any way I want. I'm free in Christ. I don't need to follow these man-made rules because I am free in Christ. And Paul says, well, no, because of the creation order in creation and in the church. Now, if you've done any research on this at all, you know that this discussion and this debate, even within the church, centers around the word that we translate as head in verse 3. It's the Greek word, kephale, which means head. All right? So when Jesus bowed his head on the cross, he bowed his kephale. And when they brought John's head on a platter, they brought his kephale. All right? It means the physical head of a person or an animal, the cranium right up here. But just like in English, in Greek, the word head can be used metaphorically to signify maybe something that's prominent, something that's chief or an authority. For example, in Ephesians chapter 5, where it says that Christ is the head of the church, it's kephale, but it's used metaphorically. He's not literally the cranium of the church. He's the authority over the church. In Matthew chapter 21, verse 42, where it says, the rejected stone has become the chief cornerstone. The word there translated as chief is kephale. It means leader or captain or authority. And so it is in our passage in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. So for instance, in verse 3, he uses kephale, not as cranium, when he says the head of every man is Christ. He's not saying that this right up here is Christ. Right? No, he's saying that Christ is the authority over every man. And we're okay with that. We don't have a problem with that. But then we read the next clause, that man is the head of woman. In other words, man is the authority of woman, and we cringe at that. In fact, it's so cringeworthy that many in the church have tried to explain it away over the last four decades with the rise of feminism in America. And so people back in the 80s began to publish articles and publish books where they tried to make the word kephale mean something that it doesn't actually mean. And you can find this in the literature, and you may have heard it if you've been involved in this debate at all. You have heard this, that kephale actually means source or origin. Now, we use the word head that way in English, right? We talk about a fountainhead or the headwaters of a river. The source of the river, the source of the fountain. Yeah. Well, using the word in this passage that way made it a lot easier for American Christians who are being pushed by the feminist movement in America. It's a lot more palatable. It's easier to swallow. The source of every man is Christ. Isn't that nice? Yeah, he made us. And the source of woman is man. She came from Adam. And the source of Christ is God. The origin of Christ is the Father. Wait a minute, we got a problem there. But anyway, who cares? At least now we can get the feminists off our back. And that's really what these writers were concerned about. They were embarrassed by a God who would say that men are in authority over women, and so they had to change the Bible to get back in step with their culture. Now, there's a big problem with trying to manipulate the meanings of words. Because there is none, and I mean none, of our English translations that translate the word kephale as source. Not a one. I looked at 25 different English translations. All 25 translated kephale as head, not source. Even the most recent translations. Now, why? If the Greek translators, if the word actually means source, why wouldn't the newer translations translate the word as source instead of head? None of them do. Now, all I can say is praise God for biblical scholars, Greek scholars, who are willing to do hard, long, arduous research on topics like these, not because it has to be done, but in order to prove to our culture what the word actually says. See, the English translation that you hold in your hand, whatever translation that might be, and there are a lot out there. I only looked at 25. There are more English translations than that. That is the result of millions of hours and hundreds of people who are PhDs in the biblical language from many various backgrounds of theology, putting their efforts together to give you a good product in your hand. For instance, the NIV, just for one example. The NIV was originally translated by 118 language and theology experts. 118 people with PhDs in the biblical languages from all different backgrounds. Baptist, 5 different kinds of Baptists, Presbyterians, 4 different kinds of Presbyterians, a whole bunch of different kinds of Lutherans, Church of England, Nazarene, Plymouth Brethren, Methodist. There's actually a list, you can find it online, of where these translators, what their denominational background was. There's Mennonites, Evangelical Free, Non-Denominational Christian Missionary Alliance, the CNMA, Christian Reformed, Grace Brethren, Reformed Episcopal, and on and on and on. And all translations do this. Every translation, a real translation, that's what they do. In an attempt to get a precise, accurate, linguistic translation, and they include so many people from so many different backgrounds to get rid of denominational biases. Well, in the 1980s, along comes a guy by the name of Dr. Wayne Grudem, who's a Greek scholar, a theologian. He's currently on faculty at Phoenix Seminary over in Arizona. And he decided to go back to the Greek literature and look at kephale to see what the Greek literature, not just the scriptures, but all of Greek literature at the time, said in the ancient Near East. And so he used the University of California's online Greek library, a collection of Greek works that contains over 2 million words of data, and he looked at writers like Homer and Plato and Aristotle, as well as people like Josephus and Philo and the early church fathers. And from those people, the most prominent writers of the day, he came up with 2,336 instances of kephale, ranging in literature that included history, philosophy, drama, poetry, rhetoric, geography, theology, and romantic writings. So here he has a collection of 2,336 usages of the word kephale that spanned 36 authors over 12 centuries, from the 8th century BC to the 4th century AD, spanning the time of Christ, 12 centuries. And he wanted to see, how is this word used in that literature? If it's supposed to be source, if that's supposed to be the primary meaning of the word, it would be obvious in Plato and Aristotle and Josephus and Philo and Eusebius and all those guys. Of the 2,336 instances of the word in his data, 2,034 referred to the physical head, the cranium, of an animal or human. That's 87% of all the usages were literal, not metaphorical. That means that only 302 of the usages that he found were metaphorical. I realize this is technical data. Don't check out on me. It's really important. You have to understand this because this is an argument out there, and I want you to have the truth. All right, so 302 usages only are metaphorical. This is like saying, you know, he went headlong into the water, or something flew overhead, or I have 100 head of cattle. You don't have just 100 heads. That's metaphorical for the whole animal, right? So, and also, as we see here in Corinthians, head was also used by the Greeks, 14% of the usages, as someone in authority, like the head of a government or the head of the house. But in all of the usages that Dr. Grudem looked at, in all of that data, 0 instances were found as referring to the source or the origin of the object referred to. 0. It was all made up. Again, I say, praise God for biblical scholars who have the motivation and the time to do this. Praise God for seminaries where they give their professors time to do this. The Greek word categorically does not mean source. Never has. At least not from the 8th century BC to the present. Now, I don't know about you, but that gives me a great appreciation for the research that goes into our translations. When you look up a word in your Greek lexicon and it says this word could have these 3 meanings, I want you to imagine in your mind Dr. Wayne Grudem looking at all of those different entrances and doing his research on those, just to tell you that kephale means head. And speaking of Greek lexicons, I looked up kephale in my 3 Greek lexicons. I looked it up in Vines, Thayer's, and Zodiates. And in neither, in any of those 3, does it ever even mention source as a possible meaning for the word. Neither Vines, nor Thayer's, nor Zodiates mention source as a possible meaning. It's not there. So whether we like it or not, whether it fits into our cultural views or not, kephale means authority. in this verse. Christ is the authority of every man. And in every home, the husband is the authority of his wife. Now remember, this is all in the context of the third clause of our verse, that the head of Christ is God. The authority of Christ is the Father. And we see this very clearly in Christ's life, right? In the Gospels, Jesus said to the Father, "I have come to do your will, Father." He said, "I speak nothing of my own accord, but only what the Father tells me." Christ is yielding to the authority of the headship of his Father. Jesus also said, "The Son does nothing of his own accord, but only what he sees the Father doing." In another place, he said, "I have come down from heaven not to do my will, but to do the will of the one who sent me." The one who sent me. A sign of authority. And of course, on the night when Jesus was arrested, we have that glaring example. When Jesus was facing the wrath of God because your sin and my sin was placed upon him, he cried out to the Father, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Yet, not my will, but your will be done." Jesus yielded to the authority of the Father. And it's key. If we don't understand this, we will never understand submission and authority in the church or in the home. Jesus was clearly submitted to the headship and to the authority of the Father. In the same way that women submit to the headship and the authority of the man. In the same way that men submit to the headship and the lordship of Jesus Christ. Now, being under the Father's authority made Jesus in no way less important, did it? It made Jesus in no way a second-class citizen. The fact that Jesus submitted to the headship of the Father did not make him inferior, and it didn't make him less in essence of his being. But his submission to the Father's authority was perfectly in line with the foundational, eternal, creative order of the universe. And it is an indication of the way things are supposed to be here on earth and in the church and in the home. Therefore, in the same way, for women to submit to the leadership of men in the church or in the home never and in no way makes them second-class beings or inferior in any way. Instead, in their submission, in their horizontal relationships with men, it shows simply that they are following the example of Christ, who, in his horizontal relationship with the Father, showed a willingness to acknowledge the Father as his head. It's God's word, and God's way is the best way. Whether it chafes against our cultural sensitivities or not, God's way is the best way. See, we've mistaken equality with sameness. Men and women are equal, but we're not the same. Christ and the Father are equal, but they're not the same. Now, we're out of time here, but let me wrap up with an example about what we're talking about and how it works out in our daily lives. And we're going to pick this back up next week. So turn with me, if you would, to Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22. Now, Ephesians chapter 5 begins in verse 1, "Be imitators of Christ." Be imitators of God. In other words, we are supposed to bear the image of God. And as we're going to see next week in Genesis, that was the pattern. God created mankind to bear his image, to bear his glory. So in Ephesians 5:22, it says, "Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands." So how do you like that, 21st century American? How does that sit with you? I would imagine there are some spirits in here that are chafing at that. Now, we just saw from 1 Corinthians 11, here again we see it again, male leadership in the church and in the home. Wives, submit to your husband because the husband is the kephale of the wife, the head. Now again, if you think that that sounds abusive or domineering, it's only because your culture is speaking louder in your ears than God's word. We've been told over and over and over again that submission means demeaning, means that something is demeaning or degrading. And we so easily forget that Jesus joyfully submitted to the headship of his Father. So what is this submission thing? What's it supposed to look like in the home? The word submit there in the Greek language means is the Greek word hypotasso, and it literally means to arrange yourself under someone else, to array yourself under their authority, under their leadership, to defer to their leadership, to defer to their authority, to subject yourself to them. You yield to them. But in a healthy relationship, it's also the response, a response to loving leadership. That's what submission is. Christ's response to his Father is the response, a willing, trusting response to loving leadership. Look at verse 25. Husbands. Husbands. We just got done talking about your wives. Here's your part. Love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes it, just as Christ nourishes and cherishes the church. It's godly leadership. Godly leadership doesn't mean ruling with an iron fist, and submission doesn't mean becoming milquetoast. Remember Proverbs 31 and the godly woman. In our culture, and far too often throughout history, the meanings of these words have been warped and they've been twisted to the point that I have to spend 50 minutes talking about one idea. And that should give you an indication of how deeply entrenched this is in our culture. In God's system, and as exemplified between the Father and the Son and the Spirit and the Son, submission to authority is simply an expression of the beautiful order that God had laid out in eternity. That in a loving, trusting relationship, someone's the leader and someone yields. In God's economy, submission simply is the trusting response to loving leadership. So, the picture of male leadership in the home is the picture of Christ's love for the church. That's a love that was sacrificial, gentlemen, to the point of death. Jesus himself said, "The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." Gentlemen, when you say, "I do," you say, "I am going to serve my wife the same way Christ served the church. I'm going to give up my rights. I'm going to give up my life." In the same way, Philippians 2, that the Son left the throne in heaven and came down to earth and gave up the glory that he had up there in order to serve us. That's what I'm doing when I say before all these witnesses, "To you, my bride, I do." Men, if you will serve your wives like that, you will never have to worry about them submitting to you. They'll do it. Just like the church submits to Christ, the scriptures say. So now, if you came this morning having read this last week, hoping to get some instruction on head coverings in the church, so sorry to disappoint. You'll have to come back again next week. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you so much for your word, that it is eternal. And we ask you to continually refine our intellect as well as our affections, because we are pressed and pushed by our culture in ways that we begin to redefine words and ideas, and we lose sight of what you actually mean. Help us in this, Father, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.